Glory, 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 glory to God. Hallelujah. This is another day the Lord has made, a day of glory, a day of power, a day when the heaven will be opened and God will shower his blessings upon you. Oh, glory, glory to God. I just want to encourage you to send out your message to your friends and your loved ones to come around, because God has a lot for us today. Today we are dealing with our need for maturity as we go on the series of living at the tops, living your life at the best. God is talking about our need for maturity, for us to grow up, be the best. This is what we need in this hour. Because a lot of people are facing challenges today, having problems because they're not growing up spiritually. And because of that, they miss out of a lot of blessings. So this we are going to deal with today is so important. It's good to call your family and call people around you to send messages to people to join us today and receive this bread of life. Now is the moment for us to call upon our dear minister of worship, our brother, Minister Oludere Lijoka, to take us into God's presence in worship.
Kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth.
On the ground, you took the fall and thought
me above all.
Glory, glory be to God above all. By Dunmuren, that was such a wonderful rendition. Hallelujah. Taking us into God's presence. The sacrifice Jesus made for us, like the rose that's trampled on the ground. He laid down his life. What a love above all. Hallelujah. Today we are going on our series of teaching on living at the tops, being the best that God has designed your life to be. And we are, our subtopic today is the need for maturity. The need for maturity. We need to mature. We need to grow up. That's what we're going to treat today, and we're taking our text from the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 5, reading verses 12 to 14. He said, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God. And you have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he's a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age. That is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. The word of God is showing us clearly that for us to rise to the tops and be the best that God has designed us to be, we need to grow up. Every mature man you see today was once a baby. Every star you see was once a nobody. One of the greatest miracles of life is the miracle of growth. Growth involves a transformative process that brings about increase, increase in size, increase in height, in strength, in efficiency. Where there is growth, it means the person is making progress. He or she is turning out better. It's becoming more mature. It's getting closer to the desired stature. The ultimate purpose of growth is maturity, for the person to get to a stature where he or she is able to effectively do what a man or a woman is designed to do and fulfill his or her purpose. The basic thing that every man, every person needs to grow physically are good nutrition, physical activities, safety, rest and sleep, learning. That's education, nurture and care. Where any of these things is lacking, the effective growth of that person is hampered. The person will not be able to live his or her life at the best. Or she may turn, he may turn sickly, stunted, or dysfunctional. This truth is also the same spiritually. When a person makes the decision to accept Jesus into his heart and be born again, he's like a baby spiritually. This person needs to grow up. There are things the person needs to grow up effectively and become mature spiritually. But it's the only way that he can effectively fulfill the purpose of God, handle life situations, overcome challenges of life. That was the challenge that the writer of the book of Hebrews had with the Hebrew believers. When many of them were expected to be teachers, they are still too living like babies. There's no problem about somebody being a baby. But when your baby has turned 6, it's still a baby. The child has turned 8, is still behaving like a baby. The child has turned 10, now becomes a teenager, and is becoming a baby. You don't know that you have that first baby has problem. In the same way, spiritually, it is like the same. Many people, they're giving their life to Christ, spiritually, they begin to grow. But there are things that expected in that person as the person grows. Years go by. There's a need for transformation, upward transformation in the person's spiritual life. It's what is expected. And that's what is balanced for the person to live a fruitful and effective life. So the rest of the Hebrew was challenging believers. You can't remain a baby every day. You need to grow up, begin to serve, and do the things that God expects you to do in His kingdom. Now, there are some basic things that we need for our spiritual growth. We want to highlight them. The first is the Word of God. Apostle Peter in the book of 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2 makes it so clear. He said, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word that you may grow thereby. Every child needs to be fed. And the simplest food for babies is the milk. Either the mother's breast or when they have the baby formula, which is basically meal. That's what a little baby needs to grow. But when the baby is growing, there's a time you don't continue feeding the baby with milk. You have to feed that baby with solid food. But this, the Word of God, is the food of the children of God. In Psalm chapter 1, verses 1 to 3, the Bible says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He says, he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. The life of someone who delights in the law of the Lord, the word of God. The person flourishes like a tree planted by the rivers of water. And then Apostle Paul in his book, second book to the to his spiritual son, Timothy, in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 15 to 17, he said, and that from childhood, you have known the holy scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. He said, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. So there is no other way to grow without the word of God. You need the word of God. You need to read it. God spoke to Joshua and said, this book of the law must not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate thereby day and night, that you may have, it may make your way prosperous and have success. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8. So the word of God is so clear. You need to dig yourself deeply into the word of God. Read and meditate on it, and that will help feed you spiritually. The word of God brings you into depth in your spiritual life. You get deep, you get solid, you get good foundation. It helps to build up your faith. The word of God protects you also from deception and helps you to overcome temptations. The word of God helps you to understand the mind of God and clarifies the voice of the Holy Spirit to you, and also strengthens your abilities to stand in difficult seasons. You need the word of God. What makes a difference in the life of a believer is a lot of the word that is in him or her. And that's what you need. And you should also know, it's just not only about reading the word. It's about doing what you're reading it, not just for you to know it, but for you to put it in your life. The Bible says in the book of James chapter 1 verse 22, but be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving yourself. When you are reading the word of God, you are fully loaded with God's word, but you don't practice them. You don't do what the word of God says. You're merely deceiving yourself. Indeed, those words will become words of judgment against you at the end. May that not be our portion. May the word of God be what will build us up, make us strong in our life, in our faith, and make us grow spiritually. Hallelujah. Then the next we'll talk about is a basic need for growth is prayer. Prayer is our lifeline with God. I must always be strong in our lives. Our prayer lives must not wane. It must remain strong. It's through prayer you establish relationship with God. Through prayer you seek help from God. Through prayer you deepen your faith in him. And then you align yourself with the will of God. And through prayer you build up your hope. Because once you read the word of God and you see the promises of God, then you are able to stand on those promises. No matter what the storms of life are bringing to you, you stand on God's word. Luke chapter 18, verse 1, Jesus makes it clear. He said, men ought always to pray and not to faint. Always, always. Just as you breathe every day, every moment, it's the same way we should pray. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. We see it also in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17. Paul says, pray without ceasing. That was a command to the Thessalonian Christians. It's the same command to us today. Pray without ceasing. The psalmist in Psalm 55, verse 17 says, evening and morning and at noon, I will pray, cry aloud, and he will hear my voice. God will hear me when I pray consistently. Hallelujah. Prayer brings you into a personal communication with God. In prayer, you relate with him as a father. Say, Father. You relate with him with trust, with dependence. You should recognize in prayer that you are loved and you are accepted. Through prayer, you communicate your heart and your desires to God. And also through prayer, you can move the hand of God over your situations, over the people you're praying for. Because God answers prayers. In this season, I have seen tremendous answers to prayer. One of my friends had challenges with a son who had a very terrible kind of pneumonia and almost lost his life. Rushed to the ICU. She just made the call to to me and some other believers, and we began to pray. And God showed up. God showed up in a great way when the young man has almost given up. God restored him. And you know what? At the end, was fully healed, went back to school, and the family is happy. We had another person who had been going through difficult exams. We have been travailing for her in prayer. She had had some challenges in the past. But this time around, we say, no, we are not leaving any ground unturned. And we have been receiving testimonies of success. And then we also have years of healings and deliverances. I have told you the story when I was given a diagnosis of an incurable disease, a rare form of leukemia. They call it CMML. And it was as if the time was clicking for me. But you know what? Through prayer, God reversed it. And that's why God said, don't give up praying. Prayer works, because God hears prayers. He answers prayers. And sometimes our prayer may take the dimension of warfare. It's through prayer you challenge and defeat the gates of hell. Ephesians 6:12 says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. So it's through prayer you overcome. The weapons of God are made of in 2 Corinthians 10, verses 4 and 5. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Hallelujah. Then the next basic need for growth is fellowship. Spending time to share your faith and fellowship with fellow believers who have become of your spiritual family. It is very important that you share fellowship. It may be in the church, it may be in the small group, it may be with fellow believers in one way or the other. When two or three are gathered together in his name, it's very important. But I want to emphasize the aspect of having a local church, if you can, is very, very important. That provides you, that the local church provides the greatest support for the believers to grow. So it's important for every one of us. If around you, you don't have a local church, look for someone to fellowship with. I mean, I'm talking about people who are in remote places where they don't have churches, or you are always at work. Get someone to fellowship with. You can even get someone in the workplace that when you come to church, you spend a brief time, if or maybe during your break time, spend a little time to pray together. Those things, they help you in building your faith. Such support helps you to grow. The Bible says in the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verses 9 to 11, say two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. Again, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? So fellowship and relating with other believers is very important. Then to emphasize that the word of God comes very strongly in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, that we must not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. In this journey, in this battle, in this race, we can't do it alone. We need support from our fellow believers. It is very important that you build around you that network. Be part of that church. Be part of the fellowship where you will be spiritually built and strengthened. Hallelujah. Then the last I will consider in the basic need for your growth is witnessing. This witnessing is your greatest spiritual exercise. Just as you need exercise, great activities to get you effective in life, get you healthy, you need a lot of exercise. Witnessing is the greatest of your spiritual exercises. It is sharing your faith with others. It's very important. That's what brings you the greatest spiritual promotion. When you are sharing your faith, you are lifting up yourself. You are consolidating your faith and establishing yourself in the kingdom. John chapter 15, verse 16, he said, Jesus said, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bring fruit, and that your fruit should remain. That whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it you. Indeed, the Bible even tells you that if you are not bearing fruit, there may be a need to cut you down. If a tree is not bearing fruit, that tree may need to be cut out. So we need to bear fruits. By bearing fruits and winning souls, we become partners of the Lord Jesus Christ and stakeholders in his kingdom. And you know what? The Bible tells us that souls brings the greatest joy to God and to his angels. So that should be a great focus for us in our spiritual growth. We all need it. It's not some people should do it. Oh, it's not my flair. I don't like it. You know, my personality is not like it. No, 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 no. Every believer has been redeemed to become a witness. We have been redeemed to join in the ministry of reconciliation. Things the Bible have that promotes growth. Indeed, that will help to drive your spiritual growth step, make you stronger. These things are important if you must rise to the tops. And I want to speak about these things, and I want you to invite them into your life, because that's what is going to make you to grow very strongly and in a very fast time, become effective. Some people stay 20, 30 years, and if you see their spiritual growth, it's still stunted. But when you grow fully spiritually, it has to make you a vessel of honor. Someone that is useful in God's hand to be used. First in that category is the infilling of the Holy Spirit and the communion with the Holy Spirit. It's the greatest driver for spiritual growth. When a person is filled with the Holy Spirit, it's through the baptism of the Holy Spirit, but you know, it's not just a one-time experience. Oh, I'm filled with the Holy Spirit. I speak in tongues. Oh, and then I can settle down. No, 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 no. It's not just a one-time experience. The filling of the Holy Spirit is what should be continuous in our life. It's an experience that comes when we get back to God, open up ourselves for greater encounter, deeper experience. He fills us afresh so that we can be out with impetus to make impact in our calling and in the assignment God has given us. It's very important. And then for us to continue to commune, fellowship with the Holy Spirit is very important. They help us to grow us in every area of our life. The Holy Spirit makes God real to us and supports every aspect of our spiritual faculties. This one gives us the spiritual ability to hear from God. The gifts of the Spirit begin to manifest in us. We see the reality, the power of God manifesting in our lives. This makes it so clear. So the Apostle chapter 1, verse 8, he said, you shall receive That's one of the messages, one of the passages that as a young believer, when I received the Holy Spirit baptism, that was my most exciting passage. Because everywhere I was going there, we were seeing God manifesting now. We are seeing miracles. We're still university students. But many times we'll go to our refectories when we preach. We begin to lay hands on the sick. We began to see the sick healed. We began to see deaf ears open, blind seeing. See, believers, open was so excited in our lives. But that's what God is telling us. God is telling us to receive the Spirit, to begin to walk with the Spirit, to meet with the Spirit. We are going to see a distinct growth in your spiritual life. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18. He said, don't be drunk with wine, because that will ruin your life. He said, instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Don't be drunk with wine, as it's excess. He said, drinking your wine, alcoholic drink, will ruin your life. Don't be drunk with alcoholic wine, no alcoholic drink. That will ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Don't compass the way of drive that alcohol gives to the sinful and drives them into some of them. If I drive them to become bold and things, but many times they are not making right judgments. It drives them to excitement. It drives them to forget their sorrows. But you know, when the Holy Spirit fills you, He drives you in the right direction to fulfill God's purpose in your life. What you need. The next, you need to revamp your life and enhance your spiritual growth. It's a lifestyle of praise and worship. A lifestyle of praise and worship reveals the depth of your reverence for God, the strength of your gratitude to Him. When you live a life of praise, always praising, meditating, always having the melody, the same melody in your heart. Joy filling you every day, overflowing. Spiritual strength is released in you. This praise and worship will keep you present in the peace of God. It means that every time you're in God's presence, miracles can happen in your life, anytime, anyhow, when you are maintaining that lifestyle. The psalmist said, Psalm 34, verse 1, he said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. It's the Psalm of David. I will bless the Lord at all times. That's the person that stays in the presence of God, whether at home or at work, wherever you are. The melody is bubbling and flowing from within you. You place yourself a special class in God's presence. And you, things will just happen in your life in radical ways because you're tuned to the right channel. You are tuned to the right frequency spiritually. In Psalm 119, verse 164, the psalmist says, 7 times a day I praise you because of your righteous judgment. The psalmist was praising God. He should tell us how far we should go in praise. It should not also just be only when things are going well, you praise. Even when things are not going well, you should keep on praising. Because praise could be an instrument of war for you. It could be a battle axe to defeat the enemy. And so the Apostle chapter 16, verse 25 to 26, he said, but at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. And the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately, all the doors were open and everyone's chains were loose. Oh, glory, glory to God. I am God's of flows when praise rise. Hallelujah. The next thing you need to build you up to be a saint spiritually, become God's strong man or God's strong woman, is maintaining a quiet time with God. It's very important. Being that personal altar, your closet, your secret place, being in contact with God, will set you on high spiritually. That's what you need. That's what you need. Psalm 91 verses 1 and 2 makes it so clear. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In Him I will trust. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High, you need to maintain that closer tie with God, that kind of quietness with God. He says in Isaiah chapter 30, verse 15, for thus says the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, in returning and rest you shall be saved. In quietness and confidence shall be your strength. Time of being in that closet and quiet with God is the source of great strength. Now, many of us, we want to all go out and display as preachers, as evangelists, or we want to be seen. But the time that you spend with God alone is the time that gives you the greatest strength. It is the time that the strength you receive a short time in the closet, or you can display when you go out to demonstrate the power of God. What we are talking about is the hidden strength of Jesus throughout his ministry. We see that in Mark chapter 1, verse 35. The Bible says, now in the morning, having risen a long while before daylight, he went out. Jesus, he went out and departed to a solitary place, and there he prayed. Jesus spent that quiet time with God. He is the Son of God, but he was a very popular minister of God, had disciples around him, crowd many times where he meets, but he will find time to separate himself from that crowd and from the disciples and be alone with his Father. It's the secret of his strength. Throughout the ministry of Jesus, most of his critical times, even to the time of his death, he separated himself alone to be with the Father. And that's why he was always strong. He was always a winner. The secret place is a place that helps you to rise to the top. It's the secret of rising to the top and being on top spiritually. The secret place. The next is an active life of faith. Living an active life of faith. Faith matters. I must say that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not faith, not seen. Living by your trust and absolute confidence in God. Faith in the word of God. Trusting God's word absolutely. And standing on it. When we see mountains fall when faith rises. Mark's Gospel, chapter 11, verses 20-24. The Bible says, so Jesus answered and said to them, have faith in God. For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believe that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them, you have them. The faith is to build you spiritually. It is one of the things you need to grow. You should exercise your faith. You shouldn't just live by happenstance. Whatever happens, you say, okay, that may be the way God wants it. So I take it. But God, move your mountains. Move your mountains. Speak to your situation. Challenge the enemies that arise against you. Live by faith. See faith. That's what God is calling us out for. Matthew chapter 17, verses 19 to 20. The disciples came to Jesus privately and said to them, why couldn't we cast this demon out? Why couldn't we cast it out? That was a time when the disciples had a young man, a young boy that was convulsing, epileptic, and they tried their best, but they couldn't. They couldn't cast out the demon. Jesus came and cast the demon out. The disciples came to Jesus and asked him, why couldn't we cast this one out? Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief. Sometimes you look at situations and you think that, oh, I think this one needs a bigger man of God. This one needs a bigger thing. It's your unbelief. He said, for assuredly, I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there. It will move and nothing will be impossible for you. The faith that moves mountain is the mustard seed faith. And some people think that it is the mountain faith that moves the mustard seed. That's not the scriptures. It is the mustard seed faith that moves the mountain. What matters is, did you put that faith into action? Did you rebuke that devil? Did you speak at that situation, believing God and trusting God? That's what God is saying. The next thing that you need to build your spiritual life and grow spiritually is overcoming temptations and trials. Overcoming temptations and trials, because these will come. Some people are praying that I shouldn't have temptations in life. I shouldn't have trials in life. Trials will still come, no matter how you pray. Temptations will still come, no matter how you pray. It's part of the process. It's part of the drill you need to be perfected, to mature. Imagine a child growing up and never going through any exam in life. Oh, you're after some studies, each semester, they will give you tests. And at the end of the semester, they give you an exam. You all need it to grow. Temptations are different from trials, but many times they work towards the same thing, building you up. Temptations are appeals by the devil or your human appetites for you to give up on sin. Temptations come from the devil. Temptations don't come from God. Temptations come from the devil, and they are appeals to your human weaknesses to move you, to get you to fall. And what is God expecting you? Resist the devil. Don't give in to temptation. Don't give in to sin, because there is no excuse for sinning. God does not accept an excuse for your sins. But also there are trials. These are examinations. They are not sins, but they are examinations to prove whether your faith is real. There are challenges that come your way that are not sinful, but if you fail those challenges, then you have failed God. You have missed the mark. So you shouldn't fail to temptations. Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, no temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. God is faithful. God is faithful. Who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able? But with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. I've heard people who say, oh, God is tempting me beyond my ability to resist. It's not God. God is not the one tempting you. It's the enemy tempting you. It's the devil. And I tell you, any temptation that comes your way is because God knows that you can defeat that devil. You can defeat that temptation. You can win. What do? Rise up. Use the spiritual grace and ability God has given you. What God expects. And then and God tells you clearly in James chapter 1, verses 13 to 15, say, let no one say when he's tempted, I'm tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he's drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. But God is not the one that tempts you, no. You know, some people will bring, oh, the Bible says in Genesis chapter 22, verse 1, God tempted Abraham. If you see, it is a matter of old translation. It wasn't temptation. If you see, the New Living King James brings it out clearly. And God tried Abraham. It was a trial. It wasn't a temptation. Because telling him to go and sacrifice his son, God was not telling him to sin. It wasn't sin. If he had obeyed God, if he had killed his son in that experience, he had not sinned. He had obeyed God. But God tried him to know the genuineness of his faith. Is that the way trials come? And every time you are tried with situations, with some kind of affliction that may come your way, yes, when those trials come, they help build your faith when you overcome. 1 Peter 1 verse 7, read in New Living Translation, say these trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold. Though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor in the day that the Lord Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. Hallelujah. That makes it very clear. Glory to God. James chapter 1, verses 2 to 4. Say, dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. Glory be to God. So the trials help to build you up spiritually, make you strong, develop you, so that you become a great instrument of God, and the devil cannot easily ride on you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Now the next thing that will help to build you spiritually, make you stronger, take you to live a life on the tops, live a life of excellence, is wholehearted devotion. To serve God with all your heart. To give God everything with a sincere heart. Serving God in spirit and in truth is very important. Honest and sincere devotion is important in your pursuit, in your serving God. Jeremiah 29, verse 13. He said, if you look for me wholeheartedly, you will find me. You see, when people are saying that I'm seeking God, exactly, are you seeking God? Are you seeking him casually? Without much commitment? With one leg in and one leg out? Or are you seeking God wholeheartedly? God said, if you seek me wholeheartedly, you find me. God can be found. But that, what matters is how you're sitting, seeking for him. It's, you know, walking with God and knowing God and experiencing God is a heart-to-heart connection. How is your heart connecting with God? I read about the experience of Daniel. Daniel chapter 1, verse 8. The Bible says that Daniel purposed in his heart that he will not defile himself with the portion of the king's delicacies. He purposed in his heart, he determined. I mean, they've been called out for an exercise to get the best boys. So they were feeding them fat in order to get them nourished so that they can come out at the best. It was a king competition. But you know, Daniel knew something, that food that was being prepared, the delicacies from the king's palace, were sacrificed to idols. And Daniel knew that this is abhorrent to God. And he said, no, I won't take it. He purposed in his heart, I will not take it, but I believe that God will still make me come out the best. So he was ready to do what? The right thing. He didn't just become defiant and disobedient and disorderly. He went to the person that was in charge and said, sir, with my faith, my eating this delicacy will affect me detrimentally. It won't be healthy for me because my faith is against it. But if you can lead me to just take the normal, some things to eat outside the delicacy from the palace, and it will be my best. And I will impress you. So when he finished speaking to the man, he was determined in his heart. Beautiful food is good to eat. So his faith said, no, I can't eat this. And the man looked at him and said, okay, let me try you. Let me give you probably 1-2 weeks trial. And if things are working out well, I will. But if I see that you are emaciating and you are not looking good, I'm going to withdraw it. You know that? It's okay. It's the way a man of faith should walk. And because of Daniel's faith and devotion, he walked out. By the time they checked him out, Daniel and his friends, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, they were looking better than the other boys. Yes, because of that wholehearted devotion, God lifted them, God honored them. And it's the same thing that God is telling us in our walk with God. It should come from our heart. The way you pursue God with your heart determines how far you can go and how fast you can rise. He said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4-5. It was a word that God dropped to Moses to the people of Israel. The same word was re-echoed by Jesus in Matthew chapter 22 and 27. He said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. He said, that's the first commandment. When we take that first and make it first in our lives, we will see great growth spiritually. Then we see what the word of God says in 2 Chronicles 25, verse 2, about a king of Israel, the king of Amaziah. The Bible says that he did what was right in the sight of the Lord, but not with a perfect heart. The New King James Version says, not with a loyal heart. A perfect heart, a loyal heart, not a life of total surrender. That's what God is looking for. A heart of total surrender. Not that you surrender when it looks that the surrendering will gain you something that you see obviously. But when things get tough, you will withdraw. Be like a baboon sitting on the fence. When it's going left, you turn left. Then the ovation comes on the right, you turn right. You are so uncertain, you are unstable. That will not take you far. The Bible says in 2 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 9, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is perfect towards him. Or in the New Living Translation, whose heart is loyal to him. So God is always looking at your heart. And if your heart is loyal to him, God will zero on you constantly. Be pouring. That's how you grow. For whose heart are not loyal to God, they take God casually. The commands of God, they take them casually. The things of the Spirit, they are casual about it. But God will come to them from time to time. But God will not zero on them. And that's what God is telling you. You want to grow spiritually, grow fast, and become the vessel of God. Then you need to draw close to God. It is your heart that makes you God's favorite. Isaiah 66, verse 2b. But on this one will I look, on him who is poor and of a contrite spirit, and who trembles at my word. That's the one. That's the one that God will always look at every moment. But the next is you need an active life of service. Active life of service. Active life of service will cause you to grow spiritually. Understand that you are saved to serve. God has saved you so that you can serve him. When you are serving, you are fulfilling God's purpose. You are also showing gratitude to God. John chapter 15, verse 16, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you go and bring forth fruit and that your fruit should remain. Now, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. And Jesus says it out in Revelation 22, verse 12. He said, behold, I'm coming quickly. And my reward is with me to give to everyone according to his work. So everything matters by how much you are giving to the kingdom. You are going to be rewarded. Then the next, quickly, I'll wrap up the rest. Giving to God is very important. Giving is part of your worship. It's honoring God. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 9 to 10. Makes it clear. Honor the Lord with your substance, not with your leftovers. Honor the Lord with your substance and with the first fruit of all your increase. So shall your barn be filled with plenty, and your press shall burst out with new wine. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, verse 36, say, give and it shall be given to you. Press down. Good measure. Press down. Shake it together. Run over. Shall men give unto your bosom. So that is very important. Now the next is showing love and compassion to others is very important. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 17. He who has pity on the poor lends to God, and he will pay him back what he has given. When you are giving, you are giving. You are sowing in other people's life, especially on the poor and the needy. You are lending to God, and God doesn't owe anybody. God will pay you back. Hebrews chapter 14, verse 6. But do not forget to do good and to share. For with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. It's the word of God to us. And these are the things that will help you to grow. Growth, maturity is your sure way to the tops. Don't ever stop doing better. Pressing on. Those are the things. Don't ever stop. Never come to a time when you feel, I think I've done enough. God will be okay with me. No, 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 no. The effort at doing more, giving, sowing the seed to get to the top should never stop. It should continue. That is what's going to drive you to the top. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 to 11. But also for this very reason, giving all diligence to your faith virtue. Add to your faith virtue. To virtue, knowledge. To knowledge, self-control. To self-control, perseverance. To perseverance, godliness. To godliness, brotherly kindness. To brotherly kindness, love. For if these things are in you and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten he was cleansed from his old sins. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. For an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is it. This is the way to rise to the top. Keep adding to your faith virtue, to virtue love, to in your spiritual pursuit, and you will see yourself as zenith. And I just want to wrap up with this. The Lord makes it the ultimate goal of all of these things is that as we do these things, it's to, for us to compare with Christ. Ephesians 4, 13 to 16. Till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ, for whom the whole body joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to effective working, by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the divine itself in love. It is through Christ. As we receive this and we walk in all this in our lives, we see ourselves grow into the full stature of Jesus Christ. As we behold his face as in a mirror, we are transformed into the same very image. As Christ is, so shall we be in this present world. That shall be your portion. That shall be my portion. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 What a glorious message to lift us up and establish us at the top.